Did you have problems in high school? Were people unpleasant to you? Did you kind of just withdraw?
Yeah, it wasn't so much. I was a scapegoat, but not in the sense that a person would be, not how a person would be picked on all the time.
Yeah.
People didn't really pick on me or beat me up because I was so withdrawn by that time, and I was so antisocial that I was almost insane. You know, I felt so different and so crazy that people just left me alone. You know, they were afraid. I always felt that they would vote me most likely to kill everyone at a high school dance.
Yes.
You know.
Could you understand why people would do that, or how people could get to that stage of actually killing people?
Yeah. Yeah, like I could, I definitely could see how a person's mental state could deteriorate to a point where they would do that. Yeah, I've gotten to that point where I've fantasized about it, but I always would have opted for killing myself first, you know. But I love movies about that, you know. I've always liked revenge movies on high school dances and stuff. Yeah.
Harry.
Yeah, Harry.
Such a great film, Harry. It's a bit at the end where the thing comes out too.
Yeah.
As in a cinema, speaking, they were just like, right at the end, it was great. Yes, I can see that. It's a kind of emptiness. In a way, you don't really get any of that.
Really?
Quite weird, but there's an emptiness in this country that you don't get any of that.
Hmm.
There's a basic sense in America, which I don't get any of that. There's two things I feel about America that want to come here. One is unlike England, where in England you do feel connected to everybody around you, in a funny kind of way. You do feel as though, yes, you are recognizably on the same planet.
Right.
Unless you really are in an alienated state, and I was in that state for a while. But basically, the feeling is, yeah. And also, to me, there's a huge hole in this country, which is the eradication of the Indians.
Absolutely.
And I just feel, at first, when I went to Syracuse in upstate New York, back to CREM,
mm-hmm.
I got this really weird vibe there. And it really spooked me out. I was like, fucking hell. There's something missing here, it's so empty. And I figured out because of all the Indian names. Well, not surprisingly, you know.
Yeah.
And I see that as being a really interesting... It's something about America that I don't think a lot of English people understand. And I'm not sure that I do, but it's just a sense that I have.
Yeah, where I grew up, there were Indian reservations. There's probably, I think, 3 Indian reservations. So depressing to go there. It's right on the ocean. And there would be, and I think when they, there was a time in the early 60s where the government decided to pay back the Indians in a way by upscaling the reservations and giving them appliances and stuff like that. And they didn't even want to deal with stuff like that at all. You know, you'd go to the reservation and you'd find washers and dryers out in the front yard, you know. They wanted their culture back. They didn't want washers and dryers, you know. And they were all fucked up on alcohol.
Yeah.
You know? Which is the main killer of their whole race. Indians were considered... we're considered the same as black people in the South.
Yeah.
You know, where I grew up. And it was their land. There weren't very many Indians that even went to public schools in my town. And it's such a small place, too.
Yeah.
They were even more isolated. They were looked down upon.
When did you first hear punk rock?
Probably 84.
Yeah. What do you hear?
Well, I keep trying to to get this story right chronologically, and I just can't. I remember I heard San. I found Sandinista at the library.
Yeah.
And I hated it.
Yeah.
And I thought, if this is what punk rock is, then I don't want to have anything to do with it. And
it's not a good rock.
It's too bad because, you know, I wanted to hear punk rock forever. I mean, ever since Cream started covering, like, the Sex Pistols' last tour. I mean, I would read about them and just fantasize about how amazing it would be to hear this music and to be a part of it, you know. And I was, like, 11 years old, you know. And I couldn't possibly follow them on the tour or anything, you know. And the thought of just going to Seattle was just impossible. It was 200 miles away. My parents took me to Seattle probably 3 times in my life, from what I can remember. And I was always on a family trip, you know. So I was always trying to find punk rock, and of course they didn't have it in our record shop in Aberdeen. And then Buzz Osborne, actually, I probably bought, I bought like Devo and Boingo Boingo and stuff like that, you know, new age stuff that finally leaked into Aberdeen many years after the fact, you know. Then finally Buzz Osborne in 84, who had been a friend of mine off and on between Montesano and Aberdeen, because I'd moved so much. Yeah. And he lived in Montesano the whole time, and he made me a couple compilation tapes that had Black Flag and Flipper and just everything, you know. Just about everything you can think of, all the most popular punk rock bands, and I was completely blown away. It just, I finally found my calling, you know. It was like that very same day I decided to cut my hair, and I would lip sync to those tapes, and I wore them out. I had them, and I played them every day, you know. It was the greatest thing. And I'd already been playing guitar by then for a couple of years, and I was trying to play my own style of punk rock, what I thought it would be. I knew it was fast, and it had a lot of distortion. But
it was great actually going to the punk clubs, as parenthetically, in England in that first year, and you'd go, and all you'd hear would be everybody turned their amplifier up to 10, and made the most horrible noise possible on guitar, which is total feedback. And all you'd hear for a year, the guitar sound, but all you'd hear would be, ah, out of the speakers, it'd just be this drone. No melody.
Right.
You can hear it on a Slits record, on those very early Slits records, like the Y record, with all the titles on the record.
Oh,
you
can
hear that sound. You can't hear it on many records, you can hear it on the Slits record.
Huh.
Whenever I hear that record, I just think, wow. It was so great.
Go ahead.
So you like the anger, and also the art of it.
Yeah, everything, all at once. There were so many different. Things going on at once, because you know it expressed the way I felt socially and politically and. Just everything, you know. It was the anger that I felt, the alienation.
And also, it's what you're saying about the Melvins earlier, there's a real brain there, and all that stuff. It's smart. It's not clever.
Right. For so many years, I just couldn't understand why, although I listened to Aerosmith and Led Zeppelin, and I really did enjoy, and I still do enjoy some of the melodies that they've written, some of the songs, but they're definitely lacking something. And it took me so many years to realize that it was just, you know, a lot of it had to do with sexism and the way that they just wrote about their dicks and having sex, you know. And that stuff bored me.
When did you start to think about all that? I mean, it's cause it's very unusual for people in rock bands to think about that.
What do you mean?
To actually not, I mean, even now, the music industry is a very sexist industry. A lot of rock bands are very sexist.
Yeah.
Where did you start to think about all that stuff? Did that come through punk?
No, it was before that. I don't know. I'm just, because I couldn't find any friends, male friends, yeah. that I felt compatible yeah. with, I ended up hanging out with girls a lot.
Yeah.
And I just always felt that they weren't treated equally, and, yeah. and they weren't treated with respect, especially because of, you know, the way that Aberdeen treated women. I mean, just in general, you know, women are totally oppressed in yeah. small towns like that and all over yeah. America. I mean, the word bitch and cunt were totally common. I mean, you'd hear it all the time. And I just, and, but it took me years after, you know, it took me many years after the fact of mm-hmm. realizing that those were the things that were bothering me. And I was just starting to understand what really was pissing me off so much. Mm-hmm. And then within that year, or those last couple of years of high school, then punk rock mm-hmm. was exposed, and then it all came together. It just fit together like a puzzle, and I finally, admitted to myself that I am not retarded, you know.